I am meant to be here. I'm meant to be here on this stage at what it is, 10:14, March the 31st, 2019. Doesn't matter what we call it, date, time, place. I am meant to be here on this stage, right here, right now. How do I know that? Well, I'm going to tell you how I know that. Simply put, I cannot believe what I believe and not know that I'm supposed to be here. It's faith. It's faith and the half a century story that led me to being here. I'm meant to be here on this stage, right here, right now. Our message this morning is going to be rather different from anything you've ever seen from me previously. In the past, I've been heavy on scripture. You've had to change pages through your Bibles at a rapid rate if you're ever going to keep up. This time, I'm going to be rather different. I'm going to be a lot shorter. And I'm going to rely on a story with a small number of passages of scripture interspersed. The story. What is the story I'm going to tell? Well, I'm going to tell a story that is going to illustrate for you that God moves in a mysterious way his wonders to perform. Now that, in case you're wondering, is not scripture. That's not actually in the Bible. I thought it was. It's actually a hymn that was written in the 17-somethings. By somebody who was born, too, in Berkhamsted. You know Berkhamsted? She can't. Can you not hear me? Okay, all right. All right, so the story I'm going to tell. What's the story I'm going to tell? It's going to be my story. It's a story of how I came to be here on this stage this morning. It's a story that only two people know. That's me and Sue. So with your forbearance, let me give you a little bit of background first. Between my parents and my grandparents, there were five or six, depending how you count them, different Christian denominations. My father's parents, my grandfather was a Methodist, probably Wesleyan. For anybody who knows the history of England, Wales, he was a South Wales coal miner. He had to be chapel. There was no choice. My grandmother was actually Church of England. Anglican, terms over here you'd know as Episcopalian. My father was raised Methodist. My mother's parents, my grandfather was Catholic. My grandmother was Baptist. And there's a whole other story there, which I won't go into this morning, maybe some other time. My mother, when she was old enough, she joined the Congregationalists, not widely known. It's another branch of nonconformist church. Nonconformists were those that were not the established church. So it wasn't Church of England, it wasn't Church of Scotland, it wasn't the established church. The Congregationalist Church in Britain doesn't exist anymore. It combined with the Presbyterian Church of Scotland and became the United Reformed Church. Kind of a little bit of history. Anyway, so between them, there were these five or six different denominations. But I don't remember any of them ever going to church. My father's brother did. My father's brother was a choir master and church organist at the Church of England. But it didn't pervade our side of the family. So church and Christianity, they weren't part of my upbringing. For the most part, to my mind, churches were interesting historic buildings. In those days, I'm talking about the 60s or so, church vandalism wasn't a thing. People didn't go around vandalizing churches. So most churches were left unlocked. There was nobody there to keep guard on them. You could just wander in and look around. And occasionally we did as a family. And there was one instance that I remember My father was asking, what are we going to do today? And my brother's 2 years younger than me. My brother said, why don't we go to that church that you have to pay to come out of? Okay. It turned out that we'd visited a small church in a place called Whipsnade. The place doesn't matter, but standard practice was the churches were open, and next to the door, they had an offertory box, rather like our little church here, our little wooden offering church. And we'd gone, we'd looked around, we'd read all the inscriptions on the headstones, we looked at the stained glass and all that sort of stuff. And on the way out, my dad had dropped some money into the offering box. My young brother interpreted that as paying to leave. Anyway, so church and religion didn't feature in our upbringing. But what did feature was standards of behavior, standards of conduct, standards of ethics and morals, all those sort of things. All the things you might associate with a Christian set of values. But they just weren't put under a Christian heading. But so, pretty well, at this stage, pretty well my only exposure to anything you might call religion, worship, that sort of stuff, was at school. The 1948 Education Act in England decreed that every school had to conduct a daily act of corporate Christian worship. We called it assembly, but it became a standardized formulaic approach. So you'd start, the whole school would gather, you would have a prayer, followed by a reading, followed by a hymn, followed by the Lord's Prayer, followed by announcements, and then off to the first class. So this was my exposure. Now earlier in my school days, we actually had an end of day prayer as well. So we'd have our end of day prayer, and then we'd take our chairs and stick them up on our desks. Made it easier for the cleaners to come in, but that's beside the point. Okay. One little anecdote. I remember one time, and I don't know why, I've not no idea what triggered this, but we were sat around the tea table. Tea is a kind of a 4 o'clock time light meal. Okay, so we were sat around the tea table, and my father, out of the blue, says, are we Christian? I don't remember why he asked. I have no idea. But I do remember my response was something like, yes, we were born Christian. Oh, how little I knew. So at this point, God says, you're not ready. Not yet. Not yet. Remember that phrase. Habakkuk 2:3 reads, for still the vision awaits its approach, its appointed time. It hastens to the end, it will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come, it will not delay. Okay, so a bit later on, move on, I don't know, 5 or 6 years. So at this point I'm 15, high school age, and I opt for a religious education class, RE we called it. It was optional. I did not have to do it. But for 2 years, we studied the Acts of the Apostles and roughly half of the epistles. Now, bear in mind, why did I take this class? I took this class to have an extra class. So I went from 9 classes to 10 classes, and that was key to me. That was important. It wasn't because it was an RE class. I treated it as a second literature class. I read and reread and reread and reread and interpreted and understood and was able to answer questions on it. But I learned a lot of stuff from an academic, technical level. That led me to be able to ask questions later. So, Acts of the Apostles, Acts 1:7 reads, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. So So I taken this class. I said, not yet. I first started to actually explore Christianity and what Christianity is and what it means when I was at university. So we're getting nearly up to date now. That's 40 years ago. I told you it's a half century story. So 40 years ago, I started thinking about it. I had some friends who were believers, and I started to wonder. I found a Christian fellowship group on campus, and I started attending their meetings. You could not, in your wildest imagination, think of any people less like me than these were. I was, well, you can see, this sort of size. I'm an athlete, or I was an athlete. I don't know if the word wimp means anything here. I know it does to us. But I didn't fit. And what's worse, they couldn't answer my questions. So I stopped going. I kind of wanted to believe, but I said, not yet. We moved on. Second Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance." So I'm saying not yet, but God's not giving up. Over the years, there have been a number of incidents, I suppose. Little episodes in my life that on reflection, I would look back and say, God's hand was clearly in play here. I'm going to tell you one. I'm going to tell you the one that I think is probably the most, I don't know how best to describe, but most impactful, most severe, closest to being final in some way. So, they say there's no such thing as an atheist in a foxhole. Now, I was never in the military, but this story is my nearest equivalent to that. Some of you know I was a diver, scuba diver. And Sue doesn't like a bathwater to do too deep, so she doesn't dive. But we went with a group of divers, and we went to the island of Gozo. Now, Gozo is in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea, next to Malta. There are three islands together. There's Malta, Gozo, and then a tiny one in between called Camino. On Gozo, there are two well-known dive sites right next to each other. One's called the Blue Hole. Now, this is a circular hole right next to the shore, right next to the coast. And you could clamber across the rocks, dive in here, swim down, and there's actually a hole in the wall and you could swim out. A little way around the coast, there was another dive site called the Inland Sea. Now, the Inland Sea was, there was like kind of this rock face in front of you, and there was water. And if you went into the water and dived, there was a tunnel through this rock face that took you out into the ocean. The end of that tunnel was a serious wall. There was a drop to who knows how deep, far too deep to be going diving. But you could actually swim between these two sites. They were right next to each other. And in between them, there was a big stone arch. The stone arch isn't there anymore. We learned a couple of years ago it had fallen down in a storm. But anyway, so we dived the Inland Sea. We did it twice. And the second time, we were coming back through the tunnel. And in recreational scuba diving, standard practice is you dive with somebody else, colloquially known as your dive buddy. So we were swimming back, coming up the slope of the tunnel, and there was this big boulder in the middle of the tunnel. My dive buddy went this way, I went this way. Okay, we'll meet around the other side. Problem was, this was not a boulder. This was the entrance to a cave. So I went in, hit a dead end. I thought, okay, I'll just back up. So I just went into reverse, and my feet hit the wall. So now I was rock in front of me, rock behind me. And I immediately, I remember it going through my head, I can hear it now. I remember saying, now what am I gonna do? Please help me. And at that moment, I looked up there. No reason why I would want to be looking up there, but up there was a man-sized hole with my dive buddy's face looking at me. So I went that way, I just managed to squeeze through and everything was wonderful. But that wasn't an accident. So, but anyway, so I'm still saying not yet at this point. Let's fast forward to 2005. 2005 was the year that Sue and Thomas and I came here to Plano. Why did we come to Plano? Why did we come to Plano in the third quarter of 2005? Timing was all wrong. Sue's father had just died. We had moved her mother into the village that we lived in. Sue's mum lived walking distance, short walking distance for an 80-year-old. And we came here. Timing was just all wrong, but anyway. But ostensibly, we were coming because of my work. My boss, it just occurs to me, I don't know why this is relevant, but she's a very staunch Catholic. The church was really big in her family. But anyway, so she brought us over here. And then things started to happen. At this point, we came here, God was not a big piece of our lives. At this point, I was very firmly with 2 feet in the I don't know camp, leaning towards the I'm really not sure. And Sue had been raised Catholic, but she had kind of rejected organized religion. There were things about her experience that drove her away, I suppose it's fair. But shortly afterwards, Sue found an organization. She joined a company, doesn't matter what the company was, but they, through that organization, offered a Bible study. And Sue started to go. It was a Bible study that studied the book of John, which has become hugely relevant to Sue. It's her favorite book, whether it was before or not, I don't know, but it is now. The other key to this study was that they mandated a particular version of the Bible. Particular study Bible, so a particular translation with a particular set of commentary, which Sue didn't really like. So having studied John, worked John, and really for the first time in her life started to understand what the Bible was about. She never read the Bible in church. She went to look for a different version of the Bible. And she went to Half Price Books and found a copy of the Quest Study Bible, which somebody had gone through with a highlighter. So Sue thought, I'm having this one, it's got all the important bits marked out. And she still loves that Bible, she still uses it, still loves it. But that's what drove that particular purchase. Where am I got to? Aha. Narrow Trail Cowboy Church comes into our life shortly thereafter. So we'd been here in Plano, I don't know, a year, maybe two. And we were expecting some visitors. We're expecting visitors from our really good friends, Marie and Derek. Marie is over here today. This is not a coincidence, I can assure you. Not because I arranged it. God's arranged this. So Marie's here, not a coincidence. But Sue was looking for somewhere that we could take Marie and Derek, something to do, something to entertain them. And she spotted on the back of a car a Narrow Trail Cowboy Church car sticker. get yours here. We've got them. And the reason I'm saying this is, without this car sticker, I would not be here. So these are really important. To our shame, we don't have one on our car yet. We need to get that fixed. So anyway, car stickers. Sales pitch over. So anyway, she saw the car sticker and thought that might be a wonderful, entertaining thing to do. She brought me in Derek. I didn't come. She brought me in Derek, and she's been coming ever since. After a while, I started to come too. Very reluctantly at first. Sue got involved in the service team, which meant coming early. We weren't going to come in two separate cars, so I was coming early too. I couldn't just sit around and watch everybody working, so I got involved. I started helping out with the service team. To this day, I maintain I never joined the service team. Anybody who's wondering, I was never part of that team. Lots of people thought I was. Then Sue, after being here for what, a month maybe, became treasurer. Sue took on being the treasurer, I got involved in helping. So I kind of got sucked into being involved. Then the dripping faucet started, and he's just left. Okay, so the dripping faucet, I will explain that, but it was a good thing. And I'll come back to what that meant in a moment. During this period, two of our elders, Harry was one of those, talked to Sue a number of times, as I understand it, and said, what's holding him back, him being me? What's holding him back? How can we help? And Sue, being the very wise, understanding person she is, said, wait, be his friend, do not push. Sue said, not yet. Now, by the way, tomorrow, the 1st of April 2019, is the 30th anniversary of the first day that Sue and I actually went out anywhere as a couple. 30 years. Thank you. It's part of God's gift to me. I know there's more. Ah, okay. Then, next event that took place. Somebody who's not here, that doesn't matter, but somebody who could ill afford the expense bought me a new Bible. Bought me this Bible, the Archaeological Study Bible. And he wrote in it, and I'm actually going to read what he wrote in it. It's something that I hadn't planned to do, but Sue suggested, and it's spot on. It says, I know that archaeology is an interest of yours. I thought you would find this Bible of interest. On top of all that, it's in the original King James Version. Okay? I encourage you to continue your study and research. If you are being prompted by the Spirit, I encourage you to move on that prompting. If God wasn't involved in that, I'd be very surprised. Too many pages. Sorry. Shortly after that, I ceded to the dripping faucet. The dripping faucet was David Keller inviting me once every few months to attend the men's Bible study. I repeatedly said, no, not yet. And in the end, I said, I'll go. And I enjoyed it. A little while later, we formed what they call it co-ed, I prefer open Bible study group. And Sue and I started to go to that, and we enjoyed that. Then one day, the next piece of the plan dropped into place, the cunning plan. The cunning plan said, the leader of the Bible study group isn't going to be able to make it this week. I was in Florida at the time. I took a phone call. I'm not going to make it. How do you feel about leading the Bible study for a couple of weeks? Oh, all right. The problem with that was I used to be a trainer, corporate trainer. And I understand that if you're leading any sort of training session, it's important as the instructor, trainer, whatever, that you know at least 50%, probably 100% more than the people you're trying to teach. So if I was leading this group, I'd better study up. And I did. I studied and all part of the plan of making me understand what's going on, I know. All part of God's cunning plan, to quote Blackadder. So I'd said earlier, important things to Sue had been, one, getting involved in a Bible study. And secondly, finding a version of the Bible, a translation, a commentary, whatever, that speaks to you. Same thing happened for me. Getting involved in a Bible study, actually two Bible studies, and having a Bible that related to me. King James Archaeological Study Bible. Just was the right thing for me. But I still said, I don't know, not yet. The other thing that Narrow Trail Cowboy Church gave to me was people that I could talk to, people that I could have a deep, meaningful, intelligent, academic, if necessary, conversation about the subjects of salvation, about God, about Christianity, all those things. And some people who could answer my questions. Remember that Bible study fellowship group in university? Couldn't answer my questions. Well, here I found people who could. And then just over four years ago, I was still fighting with, I want to believe, but I can't get past my scientist's perspective that says I need proof, I need evidence, show me. Then one day, I said 4 years ago, the penny dropped. And the penny dropped, the particular penny in my case was, surely the whole point about faith is you believe it without evidence that you can point a stick at. And once I recognized that, God said, now. And I was baptized shortly after that. And my last piece of scripture is from Hebrews. In Hebrews 11:1, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. God said, now. Not yet. Now. So, as I started, my first phrase, other than yeehaw, the first phrase was, I am meant to be here. And I stand by that. The story I just told is what tells me I'm meant to be here. So there's a couple of things I want to impress upon people, reinforce, I suppose. One is, get yourselves into a Bible study. Bible study, however deep your faith already is, or whether you're just exploring, Bible study gives you insights that self-study, reading on your own, does not. Self-study and reading, absolutely wonderful. Don't not do it. But that conversation, that debate, that exploration, that everybody in the room having a different study Bible, is so insightful, so important to getting a depth of understanding. Second, make sure you've got one or two or however many you need Bibles that have the translation that you can relate to and the commentary that you can relate to. There are study Bibles in just about any topic area you can imagine. Just look for them. They're out there. And thirdly, if you don't know that you are meant to be here this morning, please, 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 please do not leave without talking with somebody about it. Whether it's me or anybody, really. Just have that conversation with somebody so you don't leave here still wondering whether it is right, whether you're actually meant to be here. It would be easy to argue that the very fact that you are here says you are supposed to be, but if you don't know that, please ask somebody. And in closing, I'm just going to put this on. It's actually based upon Ecclesiastes 3. And hopefully this is going to work. Thank you.